Welcome to our online service as we are restricted to our homes again and the church is closed during the weekend on Sunday to keep everybody safe. We will, of course, open it as soon as we can, as soon as it is safe to. And the coronavirus gets closer to us. People we now know are affected by it, but also we know quite a lot of people who have received the vaccine. So in this rather strange early period in this new year, we set off again with our service of the word online. This year, I think the themes that will be important to us will be engaging with the Bible, engaging with people outside the church, and engaging with the wonder of God. And we start within this service by doing a little bit more about the Bible. And instead of an interview, there's going to be a short clip which tells how the Bible was put together. I hope you find it really interesting. There may be lots of it that you already know, so I hope you'll be tolerant of that. But I hope you will enjoy it, and we'll do that. We'll have this cartoon representation, introduction to the Bible for the other Sundays in January. So welcome to this service, and we pray by your Holy Spirit, Lord, that you will be with us as we record and for those who are at home.
I bring you great news of great joy.
A saviour has been born to us. Hallelujah.
Unto us a child is born.
Unto us a son is given. Hallelujah.
He is Christ the Lord. Hallelujah.
We worship and adore him. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Christ, the light of the world, has come to dispel the darkness of our hearts. In his light, let us examine ourselves and confess our sins.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbours in thought, word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And so now for the video clip produced by people called the Bible Project. This is called How to Read the Bible. What is the Bible? I hope you enjoy.
The Bible. It's one of the most influential books in human history.
It explores the big questions of why we exist.
It's inspired many people to do amazing things.
And confused many others.
And you've probably got one sitting around somewhere.
So, what is the Bible actually?
Well, the Bible is a small library of books that all emerged out of the history of the people of ancient Israel. And in one sense, they were just like any other ancient civilization. But among them were a long line of individuals called prophets. And they viewed Israel's story as anything but ordinary. They saw it as a central part of what God was doing for all humanity. And these prophets were literary geniuses.
Really?
Yeah, they expertly crafted the Hebrew language to write epic narratives, very sophisticated poetry. They were masters of metaphor and storytelling, and they leveraged all of this to explore life's most complicated questions about death and life and the human struggle.
So, there's a lot of different authors writing this book.
Yeah, and these texts were produced over a 1,000-year period, starting with Israel's origins in Egypt, then leading up to their kingdom with their first temple. But eventually, they were conquered by the Babylonians, who took them away into exile. Then, at a crucial moment in their history, many Israelites returned to their land. They built a second temple, they reformed their identity, and this is when the Jewish scriptures began to be formed into the shape that we have them today.
Okay, the Jewish Bible. What's in it?
Well, in Hebrew, it's called by an acronym, Tanakh. The T stands for Torah, sometimes called the Law. That's Israel's five-book foundation story. The N stands for Nevi'im, the Hebrew word for prophets. And this section consists of the historical books that tell Israel's story from the prophet's point of view. Then you get the poetic books of the prophets themselves. The K stands for Ketuvim, the Hebrew word for writings. This is a diverse collection of poetic books, wisdom books, and more narrative. And the Jewish people believe that through all of these literary works, God speaks to his people.
Now, there were other Jewish writings being produced during this Second Temple period as well.
Yeah, a really diverse group of texts. And these too were highly valued in Jewish communities. And there was debate from ancient times about whether or not some of these should be considered part of their scriptures.
So, this is a lot of different writings over a long period of time. Why did they put them all together like this?
Well, altogether, these texts tell an epic story about how God is working through these people to bring order and beauty out of the chaos of our world. And it all builds up to a hope for a new leader who would come and renew all creation, and then the Tanakh concludes, and this leader never comes.
So it's an expertly crafted work, but it's missing an ending?
That's exactly right. Now, a few centuries later, a Jewish prophet comes onto the scene named Jesus of Nazareth. He claimed he was carrying the Tanakh story forward.
Yeah, so Jesus did a bunch of cool stuff, was killed, but his followers claimed he was alive from the dead.
Yeah, they said that Jesus was that long-awaited leader who would restore the world. And so his earliest followers, called apostles, they compose new literary works about the story of Jesus. They called these Good News, or the Gospel. They formed an account called Acts about the spread of the Jesus movement outside of Israel. And then they circulated letters to different Jesus communities all around the ancient world.
And they saw these writings as part of the scripture.
Yeah, the apostles wrote all of this as the fulfillment of that epic story found in the Tanakh. And they were continuing the literary genius of the Jewish tradition. They also believed that God was speaking to his people through these texts alongside the scriptures of Israel.
So that's the Old and New Testament. But what did the early Christians think of the other Second Temple literature?
Well, different groups had different views about some of these books, but we know they read them and valued these texts because they passed them along with the Jewish scriptures.
Okay, so we've got the Tanakh, the Jewish scriptures. We got these other Second Temple period works. Then the writing of the apostles about Jesus. And that's a lot of literature, so what's in my Bible?
So the Christian movement has taken different forms over 2,000 years, and from the beginning, all Christians recognized the Tanakh and the New Testament as scripture. And for centuries, much of the Second Temple literature was read as part of the biblical tradition. The Catholic Church eventually made it official and called some of the books from this collection the deuterocanonical books. Some Orthodox churches used even more books from this Second Temple literature. And then in the 1500s, during the Reformation, Protestant Christians wanted to go back to the oldest writings of the prophets and apostles, so they accepted only the Old and New Testaments.
Okay, I think I got it. But how does a collection of books produced over 1,000 years by all these different authors tell one unified story?
Yeah, that's the question we'll address in our next video.
Now the prayer for the day. Heavenly Father, at the Jordan, you revealed Jesus as your son. May we recognize him as our Lord. I know ourselves to be your beloved children. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
The reading is taken from John's Gospel, chapter 1, verses 6 to 8 and 19 to 28. There came a man sent from God, whose name was John. He came for a witness, that he might bear witness of the light, that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came that he might bear witness of the light. And this is the witness of John. When the Jews sent to him priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" And he confessed and did not deny, and he confessed, "I am not the Christ." And they asked him, "What then, are you Elijah?" And he said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" And he answered, "No." They said to him then, "Who are you, so that we may give an answer to those who sent us? What do you say about yourself?" And he said, "I am a voice of one crying in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as Isaiah the prophet said." Now when they had been sent from the Pharisees, and they asked him, and said to him, "Why then are you baptizing, if you are not the Christ, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, saying, "I baptize in water, but among you stands one whom you do not know. It is he who comes after me, the thong of whose sandal I am not worthy to untie." These things took place in Bethany beyond the Jordan, where John was baptizing.
This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Well, good morning, everyone. Before we dig into this passage together, I wonder if we could just pray. Heavenly Father, as we come to this story together this morning, to read it afresh together, I pray that you would open our eyes to see wonderful things in your word. Give us ears to hear what you are saying to us and hearts eager to respond. In Jesus' name, amen. So in the passage that we have just heard read from John's Gospel this morning, we're introduced to the figure of John the Baptist. Whereas Luke tells us all about John's miraculous conception, and Matthew and Mark embellish their accounts with descriptions of camel hair clothing and what I feel is a questionable diet of locusts and wild honey. John gives us very little detail about this voice in the wilderness figure. And I wonder whether this is because he is so keen to emphasize the role of John the Baptist as one who points to Jesus, the witness to the light. One of the many side effects of the pandemic in our house has been that we've watched a lot of films together. And I have to confess to being a massive Disney fan. So one of my favourites has been the remake of Disney's Aladdin. And as I was reading this passage, one scene in particular sprang to mind. And hopefully, with Adam's technological genius, we'll be able to watch that together now. So take a look at this.
On your block to meet his eye. Make way, here he comes. Ring bells, play the drums. You're gonna love this guy, Prince Ali. Fabulous he, Ali Ababwa. Show some respect, boy, genuflect. Down on one knee. Now try your best to stay calm. Brush up your Friday salon. Then come and meet his spectacular coterie. Prince Ali. Mighty is he, Ali Ababwa. Strong as 10 regular men, definitely. He's faced a galloping horse, 100 bad guys with swords. Who sent those ghouls to their lord? Why, Prince Ali. Fellas, he's got
75 Ooh. Golden camels.
Now the ladies, what he got? Exotic type mammals.
Everybody help me out.
He's got a zoo, I'm telling you.
It's a world-class menagerie.
Prince Ali, handsome is he, Ali Ababwa.
That physique, how can I speak? Weak in my knees. Yummy boy.
So get on out in that square. Adjust your veil and prepare
to gawk and grovel and stare at Prince Ali.
Got some monkeys, a bunch of monkeys.
To give them each artist no fee.
To share the rest of the pay.
He's got 10,000 servants and monkeys.
Have to work for 8,000 years without serving him.
They're just lousy with loyalty.
I probably should have pointed out that that video clip should come with a health warning, and you'll probably be singing Prince Ali for the rest of the day. What can I say? I can only apologise. But if you notice, in the story of Aladdin, the genie's entire purpose is to serve and point to his master. So in this scene, we see him quite literally preparing the way. He clears the road for Aladdin, or Prince Ali's procession, arriving with great fanfare, getting people's attention, making sure that no one can miss the arrival of this great prince. All the pomp and ceremony, all the musicians, all the animals, even the song he sings is designed to draw people's attention, not to the singer, but to the figure of Prince Ali, the one who is greater. And it strikes me that John's ministry wasn't so different to the genie's. Now, granted, his approach is slightly different. He doesn't go marching into Jerusalem surrounded by exotic animals, but he describes himself as the voice of one calling in the wilderness, make straight the way for the Lord. And in doing this, he's referencing a prophecy in Isaiah about the coming of a Redeemer. He's signaling to his expectant Jewish audience that the silence has been broken, the wait is over. And in his context, maybe that's actually not that much more subtle than an elephant would have been. And we know that John's ministry must have caused a stir, because despite its desert origins, the religious leaders were worried enough to send a delegation to question him. Is this strange man the Messiah that they've been waiting for? And John's reply to them speaks powerfully into our culture of celebrity and the quest for fame. We read in our passage this morning that John did not fail to confess, but confessed freely, "I am not the Messiah." Despite possible temptation in that direction, John isn't there to grab the limelight or to gain a following of his own. He is clearing the way for Jesus and urging people to get ready to welcome him. What this pandemic has taught us, perhaps more than anything in recent history, is that we are not as in control as we like to believe. Humanity has been united in its fragility. Our bodies fail us. Microscopic organisms can confine us to hospital beds. We are people in need of hope. We are people in need of a saviour. And as John points out to the Pharisees, this saviour is already in our midst. In verse 26, John says this, "I baptize with water, but among you stands one you do not know. He is the one who comes after me, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie." Like John, we can say to a broken, hurting world, to our family and friends, to our neighbours and to our communities, "Among you stands one you do not know." Because wonderfully, Jesus stands among us. Among those who are struggling to put food on the table. Among our teachers, and our school children, among the lonely and the isolated, among those who are worried for their jobs and their livelihoods, among those sick and in hospital, among those caring for them, among our politicians and our policymakers, among the grief-stricken and the afraid. As the church, as the people of God, our role in this, like John's, is to prepare the way for Jesus, to help people to recognize and to name his presence with them, the one who stands among us. And we share with John his confession, "I am not the Messiah." And this frees us from the obligation to solve all the problems or to have all the answers or to save the world. Instead, we are to be those who point to the Lord Jesus, the one who stands among us.
And so we respond to what we've heard by listening to Megan and maybe joining in with "You're the Lion of Judah." Let us affirm our faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of God.
Though he was divine, he did not cling to equality with God, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a slave. He was born in human likeness. He humbled himself and was obedient to death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God raised him on high and has given him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every voice proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen.
as our Saviour taught us to pray, so we pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Father God, thank you for your goodness, mercy, and kindness towards us and all that you have made. In all the difficulties we find ourselves in as a country, the truth is that you are the one in control. Help us to keep our minds set on you and to bring all our fears and anxieties to you, for you alone are our Prince of Peace. We pray for all those working within the National Health Service. May they know your strength and support at this time as they pour themselves out in selfless devotion. We pray too for all staff in care homes, in our supermarkets, delivery services, on farms, and all those who are working so hard right across the nations to keep us safe, fed, and supplied with all our needs. May they too be blessed with your love and mercy. We pray for the rollout of the vaccine. May it be effectively and efficiently managed to the benefit of millions. We pray for all parents now having to homeschool their children. We pray that they will get the necessary support to make it a worthwhile learning experience for their children. We pray for all single parents that you will give them the patience and loving care they need as they seek to look after and educate their children at this time. We pray for the mental health of all those who are now isolating, that they may be who may be full of fear and cut off from support. We ask you to surround them and fill them with the knowledge of your love and saving grace. We pray for Queen Elizabeth and thank you for her Christian faith and her commitment to this nation. We pray for an outpouring of your Holy Spirit across this nation that will draw all back to a knowledge of your love and mercy. Amen.
Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
I wonder if you heard on the news over the last couple of days that Jerry Marsden passed away. Most famous for his first name, he was the Jerry from Jerry of the Pacemakers, who had hit songs in the 1960s, including Ferry Cross the Mersey and You'll Never Walk Alone. Of course, You'll Never Walk Alone became an anthem for many Liverpudlians and wider football fans after the Hillsborough disaster in 1989, when 96 football fans tragically lost their lives. It includes the lyric, walk on with hope in your heart, and you'll never walk alone. Of course, this lyric has a bittersweet edge as we go into a COVID lockdown once again. And at this time, I felt that God was reminding us that hope is central to our Christian faith. Scripture is full of hope and assurances that our gracious God is with us, even when we feel alone, even in the most difficult of times. Famously, Psalm 23 says, "Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me." Or take Jesus's last words on earth, recorded by Matthew. "And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." Or even our Lord's final recorded words in Scripture in Revelation, "Yes, I am coming soon." At our staff meeting on Tuesday, Sam Luscombe felt led to share a poem on this subject. Little did she know that she was answering my prayer of that morning for something new to say on the subject of hope and grace. So I'd like to share this poem with you. It was written by Morgan Harper Nichols. Hold tight to hope, amidst all unanswered questions. For even in uncertainty, there is strength to be found, and grace will abound in what you do not understand. Under blue skies, on cracked rocks, in dry heat, in desert land, grace is the hand that is never out of reach, reminding you you are not weak because you are lonely. And even if you've never heard the word grace over and over again, and you think you already know what it means, there is grace for that too, humbly reminding you of its endlessness and how much you need it when you are lost in the wilderness. So do not be disheartened when the landscape is working against you. And do not think you have failed when you are not sure you'll make it through. For this glorious, unmerited favour called grace will meet you where you are, giving you peace amidst your restlessness and safety from alarm. Amen.
Amen. It's very beautiful. I imagine people will be wanting copies of it. If you do, you just need to email St. Stephen's. The email address comes at the end. And that's not the only thing that will be in the information slide at the end. There will also be two codes for the Bible talk gatherings that are happening on Wednesdays. They're happening at 10 o'clock and at 8 o'clock, and they last less than an hour, and they're an opportunity to look at the history of the Bible and then spend some time with one or two verses. So the codes are there. Do come and join us if you have time. Each study will stand alone, so it doesn't matter if you haven't been to the first and don't want to come again. Each one will stand alone. But those of us who did that this week really enjoyed it. So we hope you'll come and join us. And so as we go into this week, Son of Mary, Son of God, we have joined the worship of the angels. May we never lose that heavenly vision. Like the shepherds, we have rejoiced at the news of your birth. Help us aim that message in word and deed to your praise and glory. Amen. Amen. The Word was made flesh and lived among us. We have seen his glory. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Great is
Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning new mercies I see.
To